So little people living out big love. I want to talk to you about big love because big love is the big deal in the Bible. And by big love, God's love for you and then your love and my love for others to show God's love to the world, we can literally change the world. Before we do that, though, there's a couple things I wanted to mention, and I want us to pray for our nation, and I want us to pray for our president. Before we do that, though, let me just say a word about something. Earlier in the year, we heard from our friend Shadonke Johnson in Sierra Leone, Africa, about the needs of Christians there, believers and disciples of Jesus. Our church had helped Shadonke's ministry to plant like 75 churches, and then we came to you all and we said they have a need, and this church was awesome the way you responded, giving tens of thousands of dollars. And Shadonke has a fond affection for this church, so when Shadonke's daughter decided to finish her college degree at Lipscomb, he had mentioned to her, and he mentioned to me, she was going to visit us. So I just want to acknowledge Tina Johnson here this morning. So we want to pray for our nation. I don't need to say to you, it's a very challenging time for our nation. It's so strange when schools are being closed, where we can't do things we normally do. The Titans are not even playing today because of COVID-19. And then in the midst of a tumultuous week, the president comes down with COVID-19 and is in a hospital. And, you know, the Bible teaches us to pray for those who are in authority and to pray for our country. So would you all bow your heads with me and let's pray. Kind God, we come to you in the name of the Savior of all of humankind, Jesus Christ. And we pray that the name of Jesus would prevail. We pray that Democrats would follow Jesus. We pray that Republicans would follow Jesus. We pray that the teachings of Jesus would be the basis by which we look at all things political in this country and in any country. And God, we know that you want us to pray for our country. And so we pray. We pray for revival in America. God, we pray that you would heal President Trump and that he would acknowledge you as the one who healed him. And God, we pray that you would heal our land. And we commit this to you in Jesus' name. And everybody who agrees said, amen. Amen. Hey, I want to ask you above all things right now to maintain your confidence in God. The one who takes away our sin, the one who promises us eternal life is the same one who promises new life, kingdom life, here and now. And that life with God present with us is a life of confidence. And in the midst of living that life of confidence, I want to exhort us all this morning with a really important teaching in the Bible. Let me set it up this way. T.S. Eliot, in one of his poems, had an expression that went something like this. I actually couldn't find it. I tried to find the exact quote, but it went something like this. Between that which matters and that which seems to matter, how do we choose the right thing? So I want to reframe it, and I want to say this as a guiding principle. Between that which matters in your life and that which seems to matter in your life, choose Jesus-like love. You and me are going to face many decisions, even decisions today. And those decisions will often be between good things. The Bible is going to teach us this morning, and I pray to God that we can communicate this well, that of all the things we choose as followers of Jesus, as those who've been saved by God through Jesus, once we've been saved by God through Jesus, may we choose above all else to love like Jesus. Now, let me set the stage by asking us, again, this question of how do we love like Jesus? So here's what I did. I thought, I know how to answer this. I'm going to do a Google search. And so I put in, what is the meaning of love, as you can see here. And within 0.59 seconds, I had over a billion answers. But the first answer was this: love, an intense feeling of deep affection. Or number two, a great interest and pleasure in something. And I realized that's not a very helpful definition. See, let me tell you why. I can tell you how I love. Like, I love my wife. I really do. I also love a really good movie. I love it when the Titans win, especially when they kick, what was it, 5 field goals last week? I love that. I love it when I see people in this church. I love you. But those are all different kinds of love. You see, the Greeks had one step ahead of us. They actually had at least 4 words for love. They had brotherly love, phileo, which we get Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. They had family love, which is storge. And then they had passionate love, where you're passionate about something, eros, from which we get the word erotic. And then they had this other kind of love, agape. But they actually didn't talk a lot about agape love. Now, here's what I'm going to do this morning. Every time the word agape is going to come up, it's going to be, you're going to read this word love, and you don't know, everybody here doesn't know Greek, so we're going to say to ourselves, well, what word is it? All the words I'm going to use this morning are going to be agape, but since agape is a Greek word that we don't often say, I want to commend to us what's in our values, and that is loving like Jesus, Jesus-like love. So in our brains, if we can just say, what is love, the kind of love we're talking about, it's going to be Jesus-like love. And I want you to join with me in realizing that in our lives, this is a fundamentally important decision that many of us are not clear about. So God wants to help us. I could literally give you so many passages from the Bible that emphasize this point that it's mind-boggling. Let me tell you why it's mind-boggling before we look at the text. I've had the privilege of doing a lot of in-depth study in a lot of places in North America, from Regent College in Vancouver to Asbury Seminary in Kentucky to Harding University to Princeton and all these places. And let me tell you one of the things that shocks me, and I was going to even get into this in more detail, but I'm just going to tell you now, is the lack of emphasis in theological studies on the importance of love, especially in contradistinction to what the Bible says. As I search through all the creeds of Christendom, the creeds don't even emphasize love. And it shocks me with what we're going to see this morning in what the Bible teaches, how important it is. So, just as one example, Galatians chapter 5, verse 14. The entire law, so that would be the Old Testament, like God's law through Moses, it's the 613 commandments summarized in 10 commandments. And the whole thing can be summarized this way. The entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. The Apostle Paul, as God inspires him, is trying to say, between that which matters and that which seems to matter, loving like Jesus matters most. Here's another passage. Again, we've looked at this earlier. I hope this becomes a little bit repetitious, because repetition is the first law of learning. Jesus said it this way: a new command I give you, love one another. It wasn't new. It was there in the Old Testament, but the way we understand it is new. A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So think, as God has loved you, as God has loved me, as God through Jesus loved his disciples and loves us, as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this one thing, everyone will know you're my disciples, if you love one another. By this one thing, of all the theological debates, of all the distinguishing traits of so-called disciples of Jesus, by this one thing will people know who the true disciples of Jesus are. This is the test above all tests to authenticate the claim that we know Jesus, that we love like Jesus. So this past week, for example, we're a church that we meet in the temple courts Sunday morning, and from house to house, Cindy and I met with some folks. He's struggling with a debilitating disease that just almost came out of nowhere. And to find out, text with the home group leader to say, hey, we're loving on him. We're taking care of him. It's like music to my ears in light of these passages. How we love one another, friends, is the big deal. Now, let me give you another definition. The simple definition is to love like Jesus. Now, the expanded version, we're going to get into grace and truth in action. Here's one scholar summarizing it. What characterizes this kind of love is that it's not primarily a love of emotions. It's not primarily about how you feel. In fact, you have to argue with your feelings. If I'm to forgive my enemies, it doesn't mean that I don't feel angry at my enemies, right? When I'm walking up to an enemy, and enemies can be really common. Like, you could be married to somebody, and today you feel like I'm married to a person that I feel like my enemy today. Right? Anybody have a marriage like that? Come on, now be honest, okay? Or it can be your neighbor, it can be an old friend, it can be somebody at work, it could be somebody at school. The reality is, if we are together with people, after a while, my sin nature and your sin nature is going to collide and we're going to have problems. How do we deal with somebody that we have problems with? How do you deal with somebody who's hurt you? You bosh your feelings around and act the right way. Agape love is a mindset, an orientation of the will. Now, let's look at what the text says about this. And again, it's going to keep coming back to it. Between what matters and what seems to matter, choose to love like Jesus. Here's how the Apostle Paul describes it in 1 Corinthians 13. By the way, this whole 1 Corinthians, starting in chapter 11 and right through chapter 14, is about how Christians love each other. Now, God calls us to love beyond the church, but it has to happen within the church. It's kind of like the biggest authentication place is what I do in my home and what I do with my church family. That's where the love of God is most clearly manifest. And so the Apostle Paul starts off, and he wants the Corinthians to know, and by the same token, he wants you and me to know, of all the things we can think are important, let's make sure that we get the thing which is most important to be the most important. So he starts off and he says this: if I speak in the tongues of men — now the Greek text, glossa — he says, if I speak in the languages, I think here his primary context is actually foreign languages. I think that's what's going on in 1 Corinthians 11 through 14. If I can speak in a language I've never learned before, like Arabic or whatever that language is, which would be by the Spirit of God, he says, that's an amazing thing. And now he's going to exaggerate. If I speak in the tongues of men or of even angels, if I could speak like angels, but I do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. Hey, you think it's really cool that you can speak in tongues, he says? Isn't it awesome that people could speak in tongues? They could speak in these foreign languages. But if you could speak in foreign languages, if you could even speak like the angels, and you don't love people, you are not spiritual. You're not. And he goes on. He says, if I have the gift of prophecy, if God miraculously gives me the ability and I can prophesy in the presence, or I can forth tell about the future, if God gives that to me, oh, let's add to it. If I can fathom all mysteries, I'm a scholar, Dr. So-and-so. I'm really smart. I know the Bible backwards and forwards. I know all the doctrines of the Bible, you say. If I can do all those things and I have all knowledge, if I have faith that can move mountains, but I don't love like Jesus, I'm nothing. It counts for nothing. It doesn't matter. Are you saying, I mean, let's look carefully at what he's saying here. He's saying all these doctrines, all these knowledge, all this Bible study. What about faith? Faith is the only thing, when you read through the Bible, it's the only thing where God commends a human being. Hebrews chapter 11, we must come to God and believe that he exists and he rewards those who earnestly seek him. It's the only thing that God ever commends in a man or a woman, and yet he says, if I have faith that could even move mountains, but I don't love like Jesus, I am, at the end of the day, I am nothing. Between that which matters and that which seems to matter, choose to love like Jesus. Now, I wish we had more time to spend here than we're going to take this morning. But he's actually walking through, in this first part, things that are common today. I cannot tell you in my life the number of people who've tried to authenticate their spirituality by some special thing by the Holy Spirit. I've studied under, and I know the brightest and the best of men. And I've known men who can quote the Bible in 5 different languages, and they don't love at all. I know people whose faith, they pray like, oh, that's amazing. But if we have all those things, and those are good things, those are right things. He goes on and says this: if I give all I possess to the poor, so I'm a social justice warrior, and I personally give all my money to the poor, I even give my own body to hardship. I'm like willing to be persecuted for the cause of Christ. I'm willing to go through all these difficulties. Yay me! But I do all of that and I have not love, I gain nothing. Wow. Between what matters and what seems to matter, choose to love like Jesus. Now, we're going to dive into this text over the next several weeks because it's so central to this whole question of how we love. And love is the big question. By the way, moms and dads, if you care about your teens, we've got to understand what real love is. And if you're trying to figure out your life today in the midst of all these people who care about all these things in our culture, from global warming to race to all these issues that are going on, the biggest question, the biggest thing for all of us to figure out, how can we love? Because it's the right question to ask, how do we love? But how that's answered is so different by so many people, except we should know what God tells us in his word. And may this be the thing that characterizes a revival of God. And it's a revival of God in my heart and your heart, that I will love God the way you love me, the way you've loved me in Jesus, is how I'm going to love my wife. It's how I'm going to love my children. It's how I'm going to love that neighbor. It's how I'm going to love that political person that I don't like. So here's the deal. Here's how it works in real life. Politically, here's how I can get everybody really charged up right now. I can make a case of how one political party is good and the other is just of the devil. And that other party of the devil, and I can make a good case, and by the way, I have my biases of how to vote. Don't take anything that I'm saying that I have personal ambiguity about how to vote, but here's what I have great clarity about. You can vote for the right candidate, and you can believe in the right candidate, and in the process, hate somebody for whom Christ died. And right now in our culture, because we don't know what love is, we are creating hostility and anger. And people in the back are saying, well, we got to love each other, but they don't know what love is. And Christian people, we've just got to realize, between this thing that matters and what seems to matter, it's always right to say, I will love like Jesus. And so if I don't like the way you advocate politically, I hope you don't know by the way I love you. And if in my marriage we go through difficulties, I hope that I always choose to say, beyond my rights, beyond what I want, I always want to love my spouse the way Jesus would. and the people at work, I want to love the people at work or the people at school or the people in my neighborhood. I want to love everybody. I want to be known. I don't want to be known as spiritual. I don't want to be known as smart. I don't want to be known as sacrificial. I don't want to be known as somebody who can give money or have faith. I want to be known, and I hope you join with me. Do you join with me in wanting to be known as we love like Jesus loved? Above all else, may that be true for you and me, and that's the real work of revival. Now, what did I do with the click? Oh, there it is. All right, let's dive into this text. I'd like you to read it with me, okay? Because the Apostle Paul is defining. This is not defined in secular literature. So literally in history, the word agape is literally defined here. Now, the shorthand definition that we are commending to you from the Bible is that it's grace and truth in action. I would like you to notice that this is all action. It's not feelings. Again, in life, we're going to have to learn to boss our feelings around so that we would act the way love would act. But notice not only is it grace and truth in action, but it leads with grace. Let me try to, this is important, so please be patient with me. In our lives, we have to make a decision which is going to be the leading edge of who we are. Because there will be times in the circumstance where holiness and truth would be the leading edge. But I hope that most times, the thing that's going to guide us is grace, graciousness, mercy, kindness, and compassion. I shared with you about a week ago the passage in the Old Testament where God reveals himself to Moses. And if you'll notice, the leading edge is grace and mercy and kindness. And I just want to say this about the gospel and about the Bible. The Bible tells us that when God sent Jesus into the world, what was the leading edge? Was it condemnation or was it grace to save? So the leading edge is going to be grace. And here's an expression that I go by and I commend to you, that love goes first. Grace goes first. Mercy goes first. May we be people that the first thing that you think we're going to react is with grace, mercy, and kindness, because that's the disposition that you see here. So let's read it together, okay? Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. It goes on and says, love never fails. So I'm going to come back to this in just a second, but there's a question that always lingers anytime you go through 1 Corinthians 13. So I want to deal with it like a parenthetical insertion so that we can come back and talk about love. And here's why it's important. It's important because we want to be a people who are filled with and led by the Holy Spirit. And we don't want on our parts to hold back any empowerment that God would do through his Holy Spirit in us. Let me state it more positively than the way I'm saying. I think that we need to seek the fullness of the Holy Spirit in all things. But we need to be discerning. And yet, sometimes we're too discerning. We're too afraid that somebody might go crazy with the Holy Spirit. And so it hinders our development. And a lot of times that happens. By the way, the power to love like Jesus is ultimately the work of the Holy Spirit in my life and in yours. So this is why this conversation about how the Spirit works is so important. Now, here's the thing. Many of you grew up in churches where you were taught that when the Bible came, the Holy Spirit's going to be restricted. It's called cessationism. And I just want to deal with it because I want you to see that this passage doesn't mean what people say that it means. And so I want you to be really open about the things of the Spirit. Now, here's the argument for some of you who are new to this whole Christianity thing. We clearly know that in the Bible, the Holy Spirit was miraculously empowering all kinds of things. Speaking in tongues, as we've said, prophecy, words of knowledge, the interpretation, all those things were going on. And that doesn't happen today and throughout church history in the same way it seemed to happen in the Bible. So a lot of people will then say, well, the Bible says it'll stop, and they point to this passage. So let me just get to it. Here's what they say. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they say, Paul says, they will cease. So there's a time coming when prophecy would stop. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. There's a time coming when people won't speak in tongues. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. So there's a time coming where gifts of knowledge aren't going to be as strong. And then Paul says this, for we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, that which is in part disappears. This expression here, when completeness comes, it was translated in many of the older versions, when that which is perfect comes. So people would say the completeness here, or that which is perfect, is the Bible. And when the Bible comes, the Holy Spirit won't work in the same way. Now, it's not a good argument to begin with, if I can just say. And the reason it's not a good argument is that to say that something like the Bible is going to come in the midst of this conversation when it doesn't even fit the context is like straining. But watch what happens next. Paul says this. He gives an analogy. He says, when I was a child, I talked like a child, and I thought like a child, and I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. So the Apostle Paul's, he's using first person. He says, hey, when I was a child, I was oriented this way, and then I became a man, and I changed. And what he's saying is, right now, we're really immature with all these spiritual things, and there's a time coming when it won't matter, because we'll be adults, and this immaturity will go away. And then he says this, for now we see only a reflection in a mirror. In other words, when God through his Holy Spirit is doing stuff, we don't understand it all clearly. It's like seeing a reflection in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. What shall we see face to face? Well, when completeness comes, when perfection comes, what is it? It is some bringing history to an end. It's the second coming of Jesus. It's being with Jesus in eternity. It's when everything is fully made clear about love and God and life, because it's after history ends and we're all with Jesus. He says, now I know in part, then when in eternity I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. So I just wanted to walk you through that, since we're going to be in 1 Corinthians 13 for several weeks, and I don't want us to come back to this again, because I want us to focus on the empowerment of the Holy Spirit that we would really love like Jesus. And I just commend this interpretation that the perfect or perfection is not the Bible, which came actually, even the Bible itself being pulled together as the canon of Scripture is hundreds of years after Paul. But what was important then is important now, is that we walk closely with God so that we can love fully in this world, even as we fall short, the way in eternity that we will love fully. In fact, let me just say this. Think about this with me, if you would. On our deathbeds, what do you think is going to matter the most? Is it going to matter we had all these really cool experiences? Is it going to matter how I was so smart, had it all figured out? Is it going to matter that, I sacrificed here and I sacrificed there? You know what's going to matter? And everybody tells you this, right? It's that we love the people that we love. Were we known as people who loved? The message comes from heaven. The message from heaven is God is love. The message in eternity is that God says to us, come and share my love with me, God says, in community forever and ever and ever in the new heaven and new earth. And if that's where it's all going, brothers and sisters, let's go there now. Between that which matters and that which seems to matter, choose to love like Jesus. Let's choose to love like Jesus. The Apostle Paul finishes this chapter. Notice these words. He says, now there's three things that remain. If you want to talk about the things that are really important, there's three things that remain. faith in Jesus, hope, which is the confident expectation that through Jesus, God's going to restore all things. He's going to take us to be with him forever. Those are really big deals. Faith in Jesus and hope and love. But the greatest of these is, that's shocking. It's a shocking juxtaposition where you put these things together. That is really amazing. Now I will tell you this. I think that when we have hope, it inspires faith, and faith expresses itself in love. At the end of the day, there's not a dichotomy between faith and love. It's just, how do you express faith? What's the ultimate expression of faith? What's the ultimate expression of hope? It is that I love and that you love, that we love the way Jesus did. Here's what love does. Think of the biggest difficulty that you've got right now. Just think of the biggest difficulty that you've got and all the ways you can handle it. Let's just think about a conflict. How about a conflict with somebody that you've got? How about things that you've not resolved? Or somebody at work and you think, you know they're wrong. And you've got every reason to have a grudge against this person or that person. You just bring me whatever, like bring before the Lord right now, whatever the situation is, you just bring it up. Here's the thing that matters the most. Am I acting, and are you acting according to the way of love? You see, here's the biggest challenge that you face and that I face. God said, Jesus summed it all up, right? What is the greatest commandment? Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second one is just like unto it, love your neighbor as yourself. Because when I love God, then God is going to say to me, if you love me, then love the people I have put around you. Now, my biggest challenge is to really let God love me, to really let him love me, so that I can love other people the way God's loved me. Your biggest problem is to let God really love you, like really be grounded by the power of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God and the people of God, to really be grounded that we are loved. That the love of Christ is higher and deeper and wider and broader than we could ever imagine, and to let that love fill us so that in that situation at work, in that situation in the marriage, in that situation with the relationship, I will choose to love as Jesus loves. That is the big deal. And so here's the way I read this passage. Reflectively, convictingly, can I say in my relationships, Bobby is patient, Bobby is kind, Bobby does not envy, Bobby does not boast, Bobby is not proud? Let's go over in my mind and all of my encounters. Bobby does not dishonor others. Don't dishonor others. Bobby is not self-seeking. Don't be self-seeking. Bobby is not easily angered. Bobby keeps no record of wrongs. Listen, isn't that true when you've been hurt again and again and again and again? But we keep no record of wrongs. Bobby does not delight in evil but rejoices with the truth. Bobby always protects even my enemies. Always trusts. By the way, this is a disposition to trust. We'll get into this later. Some people misread this. So let's imagine you're in a situation with an abusive person. Maybe they're sexually abusive. Maybe it's another version of abuse. By the way, in the Old Testament, that person is called a mocker. And the book of Proverbs is very specific how to deal with it. We don't let an evil person just have their way with us. That is not what this text is saying. Okay, you have to interpret 1 Corinthians 13 in light of the wisdom teachings in the book of Proverbs and other places. But here's what it is saying as a normal course, as a normal disposition. Here's the normal disposition. We're going to trust. We're going to hope. We're going to persevere. And we're not going to fail. That's our normal disposition. It's like the Bible says, as much as it depends on you, be at peace with all people. So as we prepare for communion, I'd like you to put your name in the blanks here. And say to yourself, is it true? Colin is patient. Colin is kind. Colin doesn't envy. Olivia does not boast. Olivia is not proud. Olivia does not dishonor others. Can you say, I'm not self-seeking, I'm not easily angered, I keep no record of wrongs. I do not delight in evil, but rejoice with the truth. Can you say, your disposition is always to protect, trust, hope, and persevere? Now, if you're like me, you read that, and it's like, oh, Lord God, I need your help. And the good news is, God wants to do that. He wants to help me and he wants to help you. I said this last week, I want to say it again. Forgiven people, they forgive people. Loved people, they love people. The recipients of mercy, compassion, and kindness are those most natural to dispel or to dispose for others' mercy, kindness, and compassion. The grace you've received is the grace you're likely to give. So I'd like to ask the ushers if you would please come forward. And I would like you to hold the elements. Dave, where is Dave? I want to ask you to start this song. Can you start it? And then we'll stop and take communion in the midst of it. Can we do that? So I wanted to read you a passage and then we'll let the praise team start. And I know it might be awkward with me on the table here, but you're okay. So friends, there's a passage in the Bible that is one of these passages that is just there and it's so easy to not fully embrace and breathe in. But let me read it to you. It's 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. See what great love your Father has lavished on you and me, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. We are the children of God. We are forgiven. We are redeemed. Jesus Christ rescued us. He loved us. He gave us grace, patience, mercy, kindness. He gives it to us every day. Dave, lead us in song.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard a tender whisper of love in dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleasing, that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. Who I am.
Brothers and sisters, will you get the elements in your hands now? And in just a second, we'll take the bread. But before I do that, let me remind all of us how with each of us, God has been patient. God has been kind. God has not envied or boasted or been proud with us. He's not dishonored us. He's not been self-seeking or easily angered. And he has kept no record of wrongs. God, thank you for loving us. We claim it. We want to base our lives on it. And as we are about to take the elements and we remember your love for us in Jesus, may we say now, God, help us to be patient. Help us, like Jesus, to be kind, not to envy, not to boast, not to be proud, not to dishonor others, not to be self-seeking, not easily angered, to keep no record of wrongs, to not delight in evil, but rejoice in truth, and with others to protect, to trust, to hope, to persevere, to not fail in loving as you have loved us. And on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, and after he had broken it and gave it to his disciples, he said, "Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take the bread. And after the supper, he gave him the cup, saying, "This is represents the forgiveness of your sins through my blood. Let's take the cup." Let's pray. Oh God, may we be empowered by your Spirit, by the truth of your word, by the encouragement of our brothers and sisters, between that which matters and that which seems to matter. Oh God, by your power, help us to choose to love like Jesus. We pray this in his name.